Respected ulama, my respected elders, my brothers, my sisters, and my little ones, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. After praising the Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and sending salutations on Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I begin as always by first thanking you, my host, for giving me this opportunity to convey the message of Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I pray to the Almighty Allah that Allah accepts these efforts of yours in listening to this message, as I pray to the Almighty Allah that Allah accepts these efforts of mine in trying to deliver the message of Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as it was revealed to our beloved Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in its true and pure form over 1400 years ago. My young friends, there are men, and then there are men. There are men like you and me, day-to-day men, common men, average men, laymen. And then, my young friends, you have men which are special. Special because they've achieved something in life. Special because they've got somewhere in life. Special because they possess an excellency. They possess a virtue. They possess some kamal within them. And then, my young friends, you have men which are rare. Men which you can count on your fingers. Men which are unique. Men which are so different. Men which are far beyond people like you and me, far beyond the average man, the layman, the common man, the day-to-day man. Men which indeed are a cut well above the rest. Men as if they are a rare breed of men. Everyone from amongst the companions of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in my belief, was from amongst this rare breed of men. Why else do you think the Nabi of Allah said, "Ashabi kan nujum, bi'ayyihim ihtadaytum," that everyone from amongst my companions, from Abu Bakr to Umar, Uthman to Ali, Talha, Zubair, Sa'ad, Sa'id, every one of them is like a star. Whoever you follow from amongst them, you will be guided to Allah. You will be guided to the Sirat-i Mustaqim. You will be guided to the pleasure of Allah. And you will be guided to the higher and elevated rungs of the Jannah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My young friends, you had men like Abu Bakr al-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala an. A man so great that our beloved Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لو وزن إيمان أبي بكر بإيمان أهل الأرض لرجح بهم. If the iman, the belief, the yaqeen, the conviction, the Islam of Abu Bakr was taken and placed in one part of the balance, and then the iman, the belief, the conviction, the yaqeen of all the inhabitants of the dunya was taken and placed in this second part of the balance, such is the iman and yaqeen of Abu Bakr that this one man, his iman and yaqeen will outweigh the iman and yaqeen of all the inhabitants of the dunya. I ask you, my young friends, in this day and age, Where will you find a man from amongst men whose iman and yaqeen will outweigh the iman and yaqeen of all the ummatis of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, of all the inhabitants of the dunya? Rare breed of men, unique, very different, well beyond people like you and me, a cut well above the rest. You want to see a glimpse of his iman? When Khalid bin Walid destroyed the apostasy, the Khalif of Rasulullah, Sayyidina Abu Bakr al-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu, writes him a letter ordering him to humble the Persians and to invade Iraq. And at the same time he orders, O Khalid, tell your men, whosoever wishes to return home to his family members, to his near ones and dear ones, Khalid, let them leave to return to their families. When Khalid bin Walid radiallahu ta'ala anhu receives this letter, he carries out these instructions to the full. And he says to his comrades, O my comrades, whosoever wishes to return to his wife and children, to his mother and father, to his near ones and dear ones, he may do so. And to the surprise of Khalid bin Walid, more than 80% of his army left to return to their family members. Whereas in the Battle of Yamama, Khalid bin Walid had 13,000 men. When he made this announcement, all he had left was 2,000 men. 11,000 men left to return to their family members, to their loved ones, to their near ones and their dear ones. So he writes a letter to the Khalif of Rasulullah in Madinatul Munawwara, informing him of the situation, explaining the situation, and asking for reinforcements. And when the Khalif of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam receives this letter, he reads it aloud, so all those that were present in the gathering that day can hear what this letter contains and what Khalid has to say. And then he calls for a man called Ka'ka ibn Amr. Ka'ka ibn Amr comes to the gathering of the Khalif, and Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala instructs Ka'ka, O Ka'ka, go to Yamama, you will reinforce the army of Khalid bin Walid. I ask you, my young friends, how many people left? 11,000 men. All he has is 2,000 men. And what is the Khalif doing? He's sending one man to replace 11,000 men and to reinforce the army of Khalid bin Walid. And the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam that were there in the gathering are amazed. And they're staring at the Khalif in amazement, what is Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu saying? And they question him, O the Khalif of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, are you reinforcing the army of Khalid bin Walid with one man? The Khalif of Rasulullah looks at Ka'ka ibn Amr in the eye and says, no army can be defeated if it possesses the likes of this man in its ranks. Go, Ka'ka, you will reinforce the army of Khalid bin Walid. And this one man leaves Madinatul Munawwara, riding his horse, heading for Yamama to reinforce the army of Khalid bin Walid. This is what the Nabi of Allah meant when he said, لو وزن إيمان أبي بكر بإيمان أهل الأرض لرجح بهم. If the Iman of Abu Bakr was placed in the pan of one part of the balance, and the Iman of all the inhabitants of the dunya placed in the second part of the balance, such is his Iman and Yaqeen that it will outweigh the Iman and Yaqeen of all the inhabitants of the dunya. My young friends, you had a man like Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala an. A man so great that our beloved Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, وَالَّذِي نَفْسِ بِيَدِهِ مَا لَقِيَقَ الشَّيْطَانُ صَالِكًا فَجًّا إِلَّا صَلَكَ فَجًّا غَيْرَ فَجِّكَ. I swear by the one in whose hands my life is in. O Umar, the shaitan does not see you walking down some alleyway, except that when he sees you, you terrify him so much that shaitan, man's greatest enemy, he is so afraid of you that he will not walk in the same street, the same alleyway, the same road, and the same path as you walk. I ask you, my young friends, there's over a billion of us worldwide today. Where will you find a man from amongst men from whom shaitan, man's greatest enemy, is terrified and afraid from? Rare breed of men, unique, very different, very special, a cut well above the rest, well beyond the common man, the day-to-day man. And from amongst this rare breed of men, you had a man called Khalid bin Walid radiallahu ta'ala an. May Allah be pleased with him. Amen. Whereas you had Huzaifah ibn al-Yaman, a man so great that he became Sahib al-Sir, the one that would keep the secrets of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the one Rasulullah would trust and share secrets with him, and he would keep the secrets of Rasulullah, and he became known as Sahib al-Sirri Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You had men like Abu Ubaidah, inna li kulli ummatin ameen, wa aminu hadhi al-umma Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah. A man so great that he became the trustworthy one. You had men like Sayyidina Zubair, inna li kulli nabiyyin hawari wa hawariyu Zubair, that every prophet has a disciple, and my disciple is none other than Sayyidina Zubair radiallahu ta'ala an. Whereas Huzaifa became the keeper of the secrets, Abu Ubaidah became the trustworthy one, Zubair became the disciple. My young friends, this man was so great that this man became none other than the sword of the Lord of the Arsh and Kursi. Sword of the Lord of the Arsh and Kursi. My young friends, this man was so great. When Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu received the Mali Ghanimah, the spoils of war, the booty of Am Gishia, and Khalid bin Walid radiallahu ta'ala anhu had sent this booty to Madinatul Munawwara, and Khalid bin Walid had gained so much booty, so much Mali Ghanimah, so much spoils of war from Am Gishia, that Khalid bin Walid had gained in Am Gishia so much booty that it equaled all the booty that Khalid bin Walid had gained in the four battles preceding this one. This is how much he gained just in Am Gishia alone. And he sends this Mali Ghanimah, this booty, to Madinatul Munawwara, to the Khalif of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And when the Khalif of Rasulullah sees this mal, this wealth and this booty, he is so amazed at the achievement of Khalid bin Walid. Okay, there and then he summons the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to the masjid of Rasulullah. Okay, O Muslimano, leave what you're doing. Come to the house of Allah. And Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu climbs the minbar of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he delivers a sermon praising Khalid bin Walid. And he says, Ya ma'ashara Quraysh, O my Quraishi companions, Ada asadukum ala al-asad. Your lion, referring to Khalid bin Walid, your lion again has attacked another lion. And again your lion has overpowered him. Your lion has defeated him. O Muslimano, a'jazatin nisa an yunshi'na mithla Khalid. Women can no longer give birth to a man like Khalid bin Walid. Women can no longer give birth to a man like Khalid bin Walid. My young friends, he was a man so great. Who does not know who Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala anhu is? He is that companion of Rasulullah. لو كان بعدي نبي لكان عمر. If there were to be a prophet after me, Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم is saying this. Hypothetically, why? ما كان محمد أبا أحد من رجالكم ولكن Rasulullah وخاتم النبيين. Muhammad was the last and final prophet. لا نبي بعدي. There can be no prophet after him right till the day of judgment. Rasulullah, emphasizing the greatness of Umar Farooq, said, لو كان بعدي نبي لكان عمر. If Allah were to choose to send a prophet after me, then this prophet would be none other than Umar Farooq. ما طلعت الشمس على رجل خير من عمر. The sun has never risen on a man better than Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala anhu. This is Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala anhu, the Amir al-Mu'mineen, the leader of the believers. Khalid bin Walid was so great that the great Farooq had to dismiss him because people began to glorify him. Because of his achievements, battle after battle, he is destroying the enemies of Allah. People began to glorify Khalid bin Walid so much that the Amir al-Mu'mineen Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala anhu feared people will rely upon Khalid bin Walid rather than relying upon Allah, the Lord of the Arsh and Kursi. My Lord, your Lord. And as a result, Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala anhu dismissed him. My young friends, this man was so great that Umar Farooq himself acknowledged the greatness of Khalid bin Walid in these words. Before Umar dismisses Khalid bin Walid, Khalid bin Walid stands before the Amir al-Mu'mineen. And this is what the Amir al-Mu'mineen has to say to Khalid bin Walid. He says to Khalid bin Walid, O Khalid, you have done, and no man has done as you have done. Subhanallah. O Khalid, you have done, and no man has ever done as you have done. But let me tell you, O Khalid, it is not men that do, it is Allah that does. Allah is the real doer. Allah is the real conqueror. Allah is the one that bestows these conquests upon you, O Khalid. My young friends, this man was so great that this man single-handedly humbled two great empires. You had the Roman Empire and you had the Persian Empire. This man literally broke the Persians as well as the Romans to their knees. The Persians would melt before him like snow under the hot sun. And the Romans would melt before him like snow under the hot sun. My young friends, this man was so great that he fought 41 battles, 35 over a 7-year period. 41 battles, 35 over a 7-year period. Averages 5 battles a year, 5 wars a year. Every second month, he was fighting another battle, another war. Yet, not once was he ever defeated, and not once did he ever lose a duel in a battle. They say there are only 2 men in history, 2 generals in history that have never been defeated. They say Genghis Khan was one of them, and Sayyidina Khalid bin Walid radiallahu ta'ala anhu was the other. Where was this man going to be defeated in battle? As whenever he participated in battle and fought in battle, he would have with him the blessings of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Battle of Yarmouk. And Khalid bin Walid radiallahu ta'ala anhu looks worried. And this surprises his companions because they had never seen Khalid in a state like this before. And Khalid tells them to look for his red cup which he has lost in the battlefield. And his companions, the Sahaba, the Tabi'een, his friends, are looking for this red cup on the battlefield. And they find this red cup and they give it to Khalid. And there's a smile on Khalid's face. His face has lit up. And his friends asked, those that didn't know, "Oh Khalid, what is so special about this red cup that today you jeopardized our lives on the battlefield?" And Khalid bin Walid radiallahu ta'ala said, "When my beloved Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Hajjatul Wida had his head shaved, I came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and I took some of the blessed hair of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from him. And the Nabi of Allah said to me, 'O Khalid, what will you do with these hair?' And I said, 'Ya Rasulullah, I will gain strength from them when I fight the enemies of Allah.' And the Nabi of Allah said to me, 'O Khalid, you will remain victorious as long as these hair remain with you.' From that day to this day," Khalid bin Walid radiallahu ta'ala says, "I have never been defeated. I have never lost a duel in battle." My young friends, this man was so great that even the enemies of Allah and his Rasul acknowledged the greatness of Khalid bin Walid radiallahu ta'ala an. The king of Daumatul Jundal, this is what he would say with regards to Khalid bin Walid. The king of Daumatul Jundal would say with regards to Khalid bin Walid, "No people see the face of Khalid, be they small in number or large in number. When they see the face of Khalid bin Walid, they are defeated in battle." He was a man so great, my young friends, that many from amongst the enemies of Allah and his Rasul actually believed that this man actually carries the sword of Allah. And it is with this sword of Allah, this man destroys the enemies of Allah and his Rasul. Battle of Yarmouk. And a senior Roman commander by the name of Jarjar, he wants to meet Khalid bin Walid. He makes his way to Khalid. And he says to Khalid, "O Khalid, usdukni wa la takzibni, fa inna al-hurra la yakzib." "O Khalid, I want you to tell me the truth. Do not lie to me, as a free man does not lie." And he asked, "O Khalid, I beg you, tell me the truth. Did Allah send a sword from the heavens and give to your Nabi? And did your Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in turn give you this sword, as a result of which you defeat and destroy your enemy whenever you meet them in battle?" And Khalid bin Walid radiallahu ta'ala replied in the negative. And he told him as to why he was called the sword of Allah. And this had such an impact on the heart of Jarjar, the honesty of Khalid bin Walid, that there and then Jarjar's next question, "O Khalid, tell me, what do you invite towards?" And Khalid said, "I invite towards the worship of the one Allah, the Lord of the Arsh and Kursi, my creator, your creator. I invite towards Iman, Islam. I invite towards Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam as being the last and final messenger." Jarjar asked, "O Khalid, tell me, if somebody were to embrace your religion and declare the kalima la ilaha illallah, what would his maqam and status be in your religion?" Look at the wisdom. Khalid bin Walid responds, "O Jarjar, my deen is so beautiful that in my deen everyone is equal. The black, the white, the Arab, the non-Arab, the poor man, the rich man. In my deen, when it comes to the teachings of Allah and his Rasul, and when it comes to showing obedience to Allah and his Rasul, we are all equal. The black one, the white one, the high one, the low man. When the poor has to bow down and prostrate before his creator, then the king living in his palace has to bow down and prostrate before his creator. When the poor man has to fast, then the king has to fast. When the poor man has to do good, then the rich man has to do good. This is the maqam and status of everyone in our deen." His final question, خالد tell me هل لمن يدخل في الإسلام اليوم مثل ما لكم من المثوبة والأجر if somebody were to declare the kalima and embrace your deen would he receive the same reward as you receive خالد said indeed بلكي أفضل he will receive more reward جرجة asked how can that be How can you receive more reward when you declared the kalima before him? Look at the wisdom of Khalid bin Walid. Udu ila sabili rabbika bil hikmati wal maw'izati al hasana. Khalid bin Walid said, the reason he will receive more reward than us is because we saw the Nabi of Allah with our own eyes. We met the Nabi of Allah. We were able to speak to the Nabi of Allah. We were able to question him. And the Nabi of Allah would quench our thirst by answering our objections. And then with our eyes, we saw the miracles of Allah. Whereas you people have not seen Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You did not meet the messenger. You were not able to speak to him and question him. And you did not see the miracles of Allah. But still you people declare the kalima, La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah. This is why you will receive more reward than we receive. Such was the impact of Khalid bin Walid on this senior Roman commander in the battle of Yarmouk that had come to kill Khalid bin Walid and the believers that on the battlefield he declares أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأنك رسول الله وأن محمد رسول الله that I testify there is no God worthy of worship but Allah and truly Muhammad is the messenger of Allah and on the battlefield now Khalid leads Jarja in prayer This man has never prayed before. He doesn't know how to pray. Khalid bin Walid says, Allahu Akbar. Jarja says, Allahu Akbar. Khalid bin Walid goes into ruku. Jarja goes into ruku. Khalid bin Walid goes into sajda. Jarja goes into sajda. This was his first prayer and this was his last prayer. This was his first prayer. This was his last prayer. Because after this prayer, such was the impact of Khalid bin Walid on the senior Roman general that after the prayer, he rides alongside Khalid bin Walid heading towards the very same people that he just come from. This time, to elevate the kalima, La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah. And he fights against these very people alongside Khalid bin Walid, only to Allah to elevate him and to accept him for Shahada. And Jarja leaves the world having offered only one prayer. This man was so great, my young friends, that with his bare hands, he could crush a man to death. Battle of Hims. And Khalid bin Walid fights with a huge Roman general described by an eyewitness as a man roaring like a lion. And Khalid strikes him with such force and such power on his armored head that his sword, rather than penetrating his head and the helmet, his sword breaks. And all Khalid has is the hilt in the hand. And before the Roman can strike him, Khalid rushes to embrace him with his bare hands and begins to crush him with his bare hands. And the grip is becoming stronger and stronger. And this huge Roman general is in the grip of Khalid bin Walid. His complexion from red turns to blue and before you know it, he is lifeless in the hands of Khalid bin Walid. Khalid bin Walid has crushed him to death with his bare hands. My young friends, this man was so great. So great that such was his robe, his awe, that he would strike terror into the hearts of the enemy. You know, you and me, you can walk with your biceps, my young friend, with your sleeveless and your six pack. And you know what? The sad reality is, even a poodle won't flinch. Balke, the sad reality is, you see a poodle and you will flinch. And this man, you know when the Persians would hear, Khalid bin Walid is heading towards their city and their town, the entire city, every man would wake up and leave the city that Khalid is advancing towards us. Such was the awe, battle of Ajnadin. You have 90,000 Romans to one side and you have 30,000 Muslims to the other side. For every Muslim, you have 3 Romans. In spite of this, the Romans are being slaughtered like never before. According to the historian Waqidi, in that battle, 50,000 Romans were killed, whereas only 450 Muslims were killed. Out of 90,000, 50,000 were killed, Romans. And out of 30,000 Muslims, only 450 Muslims lost their life. Before the battle even began, you had the naked warrior, Dhirar ibn Azwar. And the reason they would call him the naked warrior is because when this man would fight on the battlefield, believe me, he would fight like a man. There was no such thing as armor. But okay, this man, when he would come on the battlefield, he would take off his upper garment. And he would be covered from his sitr, from below the navel. That would be covered, the top half, he would have nothing on. And this is how he would fight, and this is why the Romans would call him the naked champion. Before this battle even begins, the battle of Ajnadin, Dhirar ibn Azwar was being pursued by 30 Romans. And this man single-handedly killed 19 Romans, one after the other, before the rest fled. So this was the condition before the battle even began. And the Romans were desperate. They were desperate for an idea or else. They would be annihilated. Every one of them would be killed. So they come up with an idea. And this is that we will kill the Muslim commander Khalid bin Walid. This is their plan. That they will send a man to meet with the Muslims. And this man will tell the Muslims to make peace. And then Khalid should personally meet Wardan, the Roman general, in between the two armies to discuss the terms of peace. And both generals should meet alone. And when Khalid approaches Wardan, Wardan will draw him into combat. 10 men hiding nearby will pounce upon Khalid and they will cut him into pieces. This was their plan. Simple as this. So they choose a man called David, a Christian Arab, to go meet with the Muslims. David comes to meet with the Muslims. And when he saw the battle-scarred face of Khalid bin Walid, and believe me, Khalid resembled Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala. Khalid was not a small man. He was a big man. Just like Sayyidina Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala. And when he saw the battle-scarred face of Khalid bin Walid, the effect was devastating. And when Khalid said to David, speak. If you speak the truth, you will survive. If you speak a lie, you will die. David was no longer the same man that he was 5 minutes ago. He conveys the message of Wardan to Khalid bin Walid. This is what Khalid says to him. If what your master intends is deceit, then let me tell you by Allah, we are the masters of deceit. And there is none like us in strategy and guile. And if what your master intends is a plot, then let me tell you, it will only hasten to annihilate the rest of you. And if what your master is saying is the truth, then tell him, we will only make peace if he pays the jizya, if he pays the tax. Any offer of wealth, we are not interested. Why? Because we believe we're going to take that from you anyway. Now he returns to convey the message of Khalid bin Walid to Wardan. Such was the impact of Khalid bin Walid on the hearts of his enemy, that this same person is returning to Wardan to convey the message of Khalid bin Walid, when all of a sudden, after taking a few steps, he does a U-turn. U-turn with 100% yaqeen and conviction that the sword of Allah will win and the Romans will be destroyed and defeated in respect of their plan. And he comes And he informs Khalid bin Walid of the entire plot by the Romans to kill him. This is what he'd do to his enemy. This man feared no one but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Battle of Yarmouk, and you have 200,000 Romans to one side, and to the other side you have around 40,000 Muslims. To every Muslim, my young friends, you had 5 Romans. You know, there was an ocean, a sea of men before Khalid bin Walid, all armed. And Mahan, the Roman general, he insults the believers and he insults Khalid bin Walid. 200,000 men behind him, and this man is full of pride. So he believes he can insult Khalid. And this is what he says to Khalid when he meets Khalid. Oh Khalid, we know it is hunger, food, drink that has driven you people from your homes. You people are the Bedouins of Arabia. Nothing grows in your land. You people have nothing to eat, you have nothing to drink. This is why you people have come to the land of Sham, our land, to loot, to steal, to plunder. O Khalid, if you wish, we will give each and every one of you, all 40,000 of you, 10 dinars. And we will give each and every one, we will give you food and we will give you drink. Go home, and next year we will do exactly the same. 200,000 men behind him, and this is how he insults Khalid bin Walid. My young friends, this man feared no one but Allah. And he can see 200,000 men in front of him, an ocean, a sea of men, fully armed, more better armed and better equipped than the 40,000 that he has standing behind him. And this is his response to Mahan. He says, oh Mahan, let me tell you, it is not food and drink that has driven us people from our homes. Oh Mahan, it is blood that has driven us from our homes. We are a people that drink blood, and we have been informed that there is no blood sweeter than that of the Romans, and this is why we have come. This was Khalid bin Walid. Why should he fear anyone but Allah, when such was the level of Iman and Yaqeen that his own men are saying to him, oh Khalid, be careful, you keep on meeting these Persians and attending these meetings and these gatherings. Beware of the Persians, they are known for poisoning people. So Khalid said, is that the case? Yes. He says, Tika, bring poison to me. Bring poison to me. So they bring him poison. He takes it in his palm. He takes it in his palm and he reads the words, Bismillah, Khayr al-Asma, Rabbi al-Ardi wa Rabbi al-Sama, الذي ليس يضر ما اسمه داء الرحمن الرحيم. Bismillah, in the name of Allah, خير الأسماء, the best of all names, رب الأرض ورب السماء, He is the Lord of the heavens, He is the Lord of the earth, الذي ليس يضر ما اسمه داء, with whose name poison cannot have an effect. Without the permission of Allah, nothing can have an effect. Poison cannot have an effect. الرحمن الرحيم, the most merciful, the most kind. And he eats the poison, and the poison has no impact, no effect on Khalid bin Walid. Such was the level of Iman and Yaqeen, my young friends, that when the Khalif of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wrote to him, ordering him to march to Syria, because the situation of the Muslims was serious, just like it is very serious today, may Allah alleviate the sufferings of our brothers, and may Allah come to their aid just as Allah came to the aid of our brothers at the time of Badr. And may Allah become Kafi Shafi. Allah take care of all their needs, because they are desperately in need. And that's the least we can do as Muslims, is to never forget and pray from our hearts, because there is nothing more powerful than dua. And that hopefully inshallah will solve many problems. So he wrote to Khalid bin Walid ordered him to march to Syria because the situation of the Muslims was serious. Now in those days there were only two known routes. There was the normal caravan route. However, this route was long. And if Khalid took this route, then it would take him long to complete this journey. Whereas the Khalifa of Rasulullah ﷺ has instructed that the situation of the Muslims is serious. The second route was the northern route. However, this would involve confrontation with the Romans. And that would delay Khalid bin Walid. If Khalid kept on fighting Romans on the way to get to the land of Sham for the Muslims, that wouldn't help him because the situation of the Muslims is serious. So Khalid bin Walid radiallahu ta'ala asked the army, does anyone know of any other route? And nobody knows of any other route. He asked again and again and again till a warrior by the name of Rafi ibn Umayrah stood up and volunteered and said, Khalid, I know of another route. However, Rafi said, O Khalid, this route that I know involves crossing a waterless barren desert around 120 miles long. Waterless, no water there, barren, nothing there, no vegetation, nothing grows. Nothing whatsoever other than sand for around 120 miles. And at the same time, O Khalid, it involves 5 days of extreme hardship with not even a drop of water. You will not even find one drop over 120 miles. And there is the fear that you will lose the way and as a result, everyone will die. O Khalid, you cannot take this route with an army. I swear by Allah, even a person traveling alone cannot take this route without seriously jeopardizing his life. You know what Khalid said? Very quietly he responded, O Rafi, O Muslimano, this is the route that we will take. And his soldiers are looking at him in a state of shock. This is what Khalid had to say. Look at the iman and yaqeen. He says to them, لا يضعفن يقينكم. لا يضعفن يقينكم. Do not allow your yaqeen, your iman, your belief in Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, your resolve to become weak. Why are you allowing your iman and your yaqeen to become weak? وَاعْلَمُوا Know أَنَّ الْمَعُونَةَ تَعْتِي عَلَىٰ قَدْرِ النِّيَّةِ Know that the help of Allah comes according to your intention. And when you have Allah, and when you have the help of Allah, then why should you fear anyone other than Allah? These words had such an effect on his army that every one of them said, أَنْتَ رَجُلٌ كَدْ جَمَعَ اللَّهُ لَكَ الْخَيْرَ فَشَعْنُكَ O Khalid, you are a blessed man. You are a man for whom Allah has gathered good. O Khalid, do as you please. Each and every one of us are behind you and we will do as you order. My young friends, Khalid bin Walid leaves with 9,000 men. 9,000 men, and when Khalid leaves with 9,000 men, Rafi ibn Umayrah pleads again, O Khalid, I swear by Allah, you cannot take this route with an army. I swear by Allah, even a person traveling alone cannot take this route without seriously jeopardizing his life. Look at that level of iman and yaqeen that Khalid pays no attention and he leaves with 9,000 men on a route which has never been taken by any army ever before and will never be taken by any army ever again. 9,000 men. And out of these 9,000 men, there is only one man who knows the route. It involves crossing a waterless barren desert, 120 miles. It involves 5 days of extreme hardship without a single drop of water and the fear of losing the way. Look at the Iman and Yaqeen. Khalid leaves with 9,000 men. In the month of June, when the sun does not forgive, when the sun is merciless, and you know the heat of Iraq and Arabia, 40, 50 degrees centigrade in an open, waterless, barren desert. He leaves with 9,000 men. In such a condition, my young friends, that on the fourth day, there was not a single drop of water. 9,000 men, and between them, they do not have one drop of water, and they're still walking, heading towards the land of Sham. The fifth day, they do not have one drop of water. My young friends, the throats are on fire. Their tongues have swollen. The words flowing in their minds, Hasbunallah wa ni'mal wakeel. Allah will suffice us. Allah is the best of protectors. My young friends, the men reach the limit of human endurance. The one man out of 9,000 men that knew the route, even he became blind. But such was the level of yaqeen, my young friends, that Khalid bin Walid crossed this desert and he succeeded in crossing with 9,000 men. Not one dropped dead. 9,000 men crossed this desert. And when they get to this spring, after this desert, the very same man, Rafi ibn Umayrah, comes to Khalid bin Walid with a smile on his face. And he says to Khalid, "Oh Khalid, I have only ever alighted at this spring once in my life. I've only ever come here once. And that was 30 years ago when I traveled with my father as a child. This is the only time I have ever crossed this desert." This is what you call Iman, and this is what you call Yaqeen. My young friends, what did I go back? 2 minutes?
5 minutes.
5 minutes, guys. 5 minutes it is. I mean, don't know what part to tell you, what part not to tell you. So I might just not tell you anything and finish. I'm just going to conclude by telling you as to how he got his name, the Sword of Allah. And I think that will suffice for today. Battle of Battle of Muta. 3,000 men, Muslims, 200,000 kuffar. 100,000 Arabs, 100,000 Romans. Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam appoints Zayd ibn Harisa, the adopted son of Rasulullah, as the leader of the Muslims. And when he appointed Zayd, he said, "If Zayd is killed, you will choose Sayyidina Ja'far. And if Ja'far dies, Abdullah bin Rawaha will be your leader. And if Abdullah bin Rawaha dies, you will choose a leader from amongst yourselves." Now the Muslims are hesitant. 3,000 to one side, 200,000 to the other. Abdullah bin Rawaha encourages them. "Oh Muslimano, why you are afraid? This is why you left your homes. You left your homes for Shahada, for martyrdom. Why you afraid? Oh Muslimano, remember, we never fight by our large numbers. We never fight by our strength in arms, in weapons, planes, tanks. No, no, no. We fight by Allah and we fight by Islam. And it is through Islam Allah elevates and Allah honors us. You are sure of one or two things. You are sure of Shahada or you are sure of victory." Saying this, he encourages the believers and the battle begins. And just as Nabi Kareem Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam predicted, Zayd ibn Harisa was the first to die. Rasulullah is in Medina. The Muslims are fighting in Jordan, in Muta, hundreds of miles away. And miraculously, Rasulullah can see what is happening. And as the battle continues and unfolds, Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is informing the Sahaba in Medina. Ja'far takes the flag of Islam. And you know what he does first? He takes his sword and he disables his horse. He cuts off the legs of his horse. Why? He'd made firm intentions today. There's no such thing as returning to Madinatul Munawwara. There is no such thing as going back to my wife and children and to seeing the Nabi of Allah. Today is the day Ja'far will see Allah and meet Allah. So he made intentions. He takes the flag in one hand, the sword in the other, and he advances towards the enemy. And the enemy cut off one hand. He takes the flag in the other. The enemy cut off the other hand. My young friends, now he's lost both hands. He takes the flag in his bleeding arms and his teeth. And the enemy come and cut him into pieces. Abdullah bin Umar says, when we carried his body from the battlefield, he had 90 wounds on his body. Every single one was at the front, none was at the back. Meaning he was advancing, not retreating. Sayyidina Abdullah bin Rawaha, at the time when Ja'far was killed, was sitting in one corner of the battlefield. And he had a piece of meat in his hand, because for 3 days this man had not slept and not eaten. And he's about to eat this piece of meat when he's informed Ja'far is no more. So he says to himself, "O Abdullah, you are busy eating this meat when Ja'far has already gone to paradise." He throws the meat away and he heads towards the enemy with the flag of Islam in his hand. He heads towards the enemy, his finger is cut, it's hanging loose by the skin only. Look at this. He places it under his feet, he raises himself, he throws the finger away, and he advances towards the enemy. As he advances, the thought crosses his mind, 200,000 men, I can't do it. And he stops and he's hesitant. His nafs has got the better of him. On the battlefield now, he begins to fight with his nafs, and he begins to say to his nafs, "Why are you afraid?" He's saying that to himself. Why are you afraid? Why are you not going forward? Is it because you love your wife? On the battlefield, he divorces his wife. Is it because of your wife you're not going? If that's the case, I divorce her. Is it because of the slaves, your slaves that you possess? Is that why you're not going? If that's the case, he frees every slave on the battlefield. Is it because of the love of the garden that you have, the orchard that you have? Is that why you're not going? If that's the case, he gives that a sadaqah on the battlefield. He gets off his horse. Meanwhile, his cousin brings him a piece of meat and says, "Look, you haven't eaten for days. Eat this for a short while. Take a little rest and you can fight the enemy." He's about to do so when he hears the uproar of the enemy. He throws the meat away. He rushes towards the enemy and he fights and he's no more. Now a man called Thabit ibn al-Akram takes the flag of Islam and he shouts to the Muslims, "O Muslimano, choose a leader from amongst yourself." And this honor was bestowed upon none other than Khalid bin Walid. Everyone unanimously agreed he should be the next Muslim leader. Khalid takes the flag of Islam in Muta, and Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in Madinah al-Munawwara gives him the title Akhadha ar-rayat as-sayf min suyufillah hatta fataha Allahu alayhim. Nabi Karim sallallahu alaihi wasallam can see this from Medina, and Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is saying, now the flag has been taken by a sword from amongst the swords of Allah till Allah bestowed victory upon him. And indeed that was true. My young friends, in that battle, Khalid bin Walid broke 9 swords. I ask you, my young friends, how can you break 9 swords in a battle? You know, if you go visit a Muslim museum at this moment in time, you'll realize people like you and me can't even carry that sword, never mind fight with it. This is how heavy them swords were. You can't even carry one, never mind fight with one. So how does a man break 9 swords in battle? How does he do that? How much energy do you think, and effort, and sacrifice, and how much commitment and dedication do you have to break 9 swords? He reshuffles the Muslim army. He changes the strategy, as a result of which the Romans began to believe reinforcements have arrived from Madinatul Munawwara, and the Muslims are drawing them in the desert to trap them, as a result of which the Romans stopped pursuing the Muslims, and the Muslims were able to retreat to Madinatul Munawwara. This is how he saved the believers. You know, one's aqal and one's intellect says the entire Muslim army should have been annihilated. Because if you look at it in reality, 3,000 to one side, 200,000 to the other side, what chance did the Muslims have? How many Muslims do you think were killed in that battle? If you open the books of history, you will see 12 Muslims were killed in that battle. Whereas the number of Romans, only Allah himself knows. This was down to the brilliance and the ingenuity of Khalid bin Walid. And this is how he became the sword of Allah. And once he became the sword of Allah, and my young friends, believe me, it was only 6 months after he declared the kalima. 6-7 months. Strived and sacrificed that this is the title that Allah gave him. وَمَا يَنْتِكُ عَنِ الْحَوَىٰ إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوهَىٰ. Whatever Muhammad said, it is because Allah said this. So Allah gave him this title. And wherever the sword of Allah went thereafter, it left a trail of glory. Trail of glory, my young friends. And on this note, I end because it is time for Salah. Allah give me the tawfiq to follow in the footsteps of our pious predecessors. Amen. And Allah make us like them. You know, we need to strive and sacrifice and make a difference like these people made a difference. He embraced Islam in the latter part of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam's life, just before Makkah was conquered in the 8th year of Hijrah, end of 7, in the 8th. Now look at how much he achieved. You know, there was no such thing as now I'm a Muslim, I'm free from sin, I'll sit down and Jannah I'm going to get anyway. There was no such thing like that, my young friends. It was striving, sacrificing, making a difference. We can also make a difference within our communities here. Study hard, work hard, make a difference. Get somewhere in life that people look up to you. Let us see if we can bring about Muslim Spain once again. When the entire dunya was at our feet, the kings of Rome would attend our gatherings. And we were at the forefront of everything. We were making everything. We were the ones that were making the discoveries. We were the ones that were inventing. And at this moment in time, the entire ummah today cannot make anything. And we are dependent for even the toilet paper that we use to clean ourselves from someone else. And if that is not shameful and enough for us to drop our heads, then what is? We are so blessed that we live in this country and we have opportunity to get somewhere and to make a difference. Let's make that difference. Allah give me tawfiq, Allah give you tawfiq.